Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, honorable former Ambassador Evans, Mr. Sasunyan, members of the ARF Central Committee, local Rostov Committee, friends and family. My name is Gurian Mukherjan. I'm a member of the local ANCA San Fernando West chapter, and it is great to see a lot of you show up today. I'm so sorry for the microphone. I'm not sure if you can hear me. All right, perfect. On behalf of the your local NCA chapter, we're happy to bring you our first speaker event. This is not the first one, so everybody please, you know, stay close with the NCA chapter. We're going to have a lot of events like this, and we're really, really happy to see, especially the young people who have joined us today, because you can learn a lot about this, and together we can fight the Armenian fight. It's a very important day today. Today we're going to not only appreciate and thank Mr. Ambassador Evans, we're also going to learn a lot from him. We have asked him to talk about how a diplomat should be, how a diplomat should act, and what we need to do in order for us to move the Armenian cause forward. However, with all the career success, she has stayed a very active member of our community. She currently is a board member with us at the ANCA San Fernando West chapter. So please help me to welcome Nora Demirchan.
Good evening, everybody. The ANCA is an organization that would not succeed without its grassroots efforts. The local chapters are a key component to that success. There are 16 local chapters in California, plus an additional 12 chapters spread throughout the Western region. These local chapters consistently recruit new members and activists, and all these members coordinate and communicate our goals to elected officials across the country. In 2016 alone, these efforts led to the establishment of a new office in Denver, the defeat of a pro-Azeri resolution in Idaho, and advocacy days and town hall meetings in Texas, Arizona, Nevada, Utah, and Washington. One of the strongest focal points of the ANCA is creating youth and leadership development programs and engaging the younger generation in our collective pursuit of the Armenian cause by encouraging them to participate in the ANCA Western Region Internship Program, the ANCA Leo Sarkisian Internship Program in DC, the Capital Gateway Program, which helps college-educated students find jobs in the Washington, DC area, and the newly established Walter and Laurel Karapian Public Policy Fellowship in Sacramento. No other organization does more to engage their youth, who will continue to promote our community to new heights. The local chapters are now more important than ever. We are the voices of... Another example of local success is with voter registration. The Western Region, working with local chapters and partner organizations from Colorado, Las Vegas, Sacramento, and San Francisco, to Hollywood, Pasadena, Glendale, the San Fernando Valley, Sunland Tujunga, and all the way to South Bay and San Diego, the Hot Votes Registration, Voter Registration, and Get Out the Votes initiative resulted in over 10,000 new Armenian American registered voters leading up to the primary. And Sacramento Bee newspapers said the growth of the Armenian American voting bloc is a force to be reckoned with. None of these goals can be accomplished without our local communities and active members. Every single person has a role to play in this organization, whether we are defending Artsakh from Azeri attacks, providing aid to our community in war-torn Syria, working hard to provide economic development and prosperity to those living in Armenia, or creating new ways to educate and further ourselves and those around us. Every single one of us has a role to play to ensure our success. Don't underestimate the role an individual can play to further our goals, and I think Ambassador Evans is a true testament to that. I also have the pleasure of introducing someone who needs no introduction in this community. Our moderator today is Mr. Harut Sasunyan. Harut Sasunyan is a publisher, syndicated columnist, TV commentator, author, filmmaker, human rights activist, and president of Armenia Artsakh Fund. For his humanitarian efforts, he has been decorated by the President and Prime Minister of the Republic of Armenia, as well as the heads of the Armenian Apostolic and Catholic Churches. He is also the recipient of the Ellis Island Medal of Honor. His weekly commentaries in the California Courier are translated into Russian, French, Arabic, and Armenian, and reprinted in dozens of publications in various countries and posted on countless websites, including the Huffington Post. As a political commentator, he appears on US-Armenia TV each week, where he analyzes the latest political developments. Sassoonian served as a human rights delegate at the United Nations in Geneva, Switzerland, from 1978 to 1988. He played a key role in the recognition of the Armenian Genocide by the UN Subcommission on Prevention of Discrimination and Protection of Minorities in 1985. He has a master's degree in international affairs from Columbia University in New York and an MBA from Pepperdine University here in Los Angeles. Sassoonian is the author of The Armenian Genocide, The World Speaks Out, 1915 to 2015, Documents and Declarations. Please join me in welcoming Mr. Havid Sassoonian.
Good afternoon. It's a distinct honor for me to make the introduction of Ambassador Evans, a well-known figure worldwide, Armenian communities and others, but also as a good friend for many years. We worked together when I was ambassador, and we've been very close and in touch since then. I'm honored by that. I'll make some comments about him and along with his background. Ambassador Evans is a learned man and a seasoned diplomat. He studied Russian history at Yale and Columbia. He speaks Russian, French, Czech, some Farsi, and some Armenian. He's an Armenian. Maybe he'll say a few words in Armenian today. Or give the lecture in Armenian. I don't know. Ambassador Evans served in various diplomatic posts in Tehran, Prague, Moscow, St. Petersburg, the US mission to NATO. He was deputy director of the Soviet desk and US ambassador to Armenia from 2004 to 2006. In February 2005, during his tour of the Armenian American communities, Ambassador Evans violated the US government's gag rule by calling the Armenian Genocide a genocide. He knew that his honesty would cost him his job, and it did. No federal government official had dared to use the term Armenian Genocide since President Reagan in 1981. Successive US administrations, both Republican and Democrat, had avoided the term Armenian Genocide to please Turkey and side with its denialist policy. After Turkish officials and their lobbyists complained about Ambassador Evans' reference to Armenian Genocide, the State Department forced him into quote-unquote early retirement from the US Foreign Service. His highly competent diplomat's career was cut short because of his honesty. Strangely, those who tell the truth are getting fired, not those who lie. For Armenians worldwide, Ambassador Evans is a modern-day Henry Morgenthau, another righteous US ambassador who did everything in his power to rescue perishing Armenians in 1915. During his tenure in Armenia from 2004-2006, Ambassador Evans was deeply involved in every aspect of Armenian life. He went beyond the call of duty to assist the Republic of Armenia. Ambassador Evans deserves the eternal gratitude of the Armenian nation for his distinguished service to the United States of America and the Republic of Armenia, and for sacrificing his career for the Armenian cause.
Thank you all, and thank you very much, Haru. But nobody needs to thank me. So when you say that someone owes me gratitude, they don't. But we can discuss that. Ladies and gentlemen, as I started to say, I was asked today to talk about the profession of diplomacy and the question of diplomatic careers for young people. Now, I see that this audience does have a significant number of young people, but there are some people of a certain age who may not be going into the profession of diplomacy. So I'm going to mix it up a little bit. My proposal is to talk briefly about diplomacy as a career and as maybe a larger vocation. Then I'll say a few words about my book just so that people will know about that. But I think that the issue that so many of you and others of us who care about Armenia are concerned about now is the question of Artsakh. And in fact, the main invitation to me on this trip was by the AGBU Auspets, who wanted particularly to talk about Artsakh. So I'll leave that for number three. The profession of diplomacy has been called the world's second oldest profession. Let that sink in for a second. And it does go back to very ancient times when different communities, the city-states of Greece, for example, found it necessary to communicate with the enemy and to send envoys to that enemy to see if there was a chance of maybe having a ceasefire, or perhaps there was some other, maybe there was a common enemy and they wanted to check with their neighbors to see if they could make a common cause against the external threat. So diplomacy arises from very human situations that have existed all through civilization's history, as different communities have found themselves at loggerheads and under threat and needing to communicate authoritatively with each other. And I mention that word authoritatively because a diplomat, by definition, is someone who is authorized to speak for the sending authority, whether it's a king or an emperor, or even the church has its diplomats. A diplomat, that's what this whole business about presenting credentials. You hear that when an ambassador goes to a foreign country, the first thing he does before he's accepted is he must present letters of credence, which means these are letters that say, yes, this is the guy who speaks for us to you. And until that procedure is accomplished, the ambassador is just a visiting diplomat, but he's not accredited. Now, a lot of things over the years, a lot of legal and traditional developments have adhered to the question of who is a diplomat and how diplomats act. And one of the most important ones is that you don't kill the diplomats of the other country. Now, that in its most raw form. I mean, in the old days, it happened that a diplomat sent, or an envoy sent by the king of Sparta to Athens, well, maybe that's not a good example, but to another kingdom, might be slain at the gates of the city. Gradually the practice developed that the diplomats would be, by convention, accepted and not slain, and listened to, maybe then slain. But eventually the world got to the point where, by and large, diplomats enter and exit the country of their assignment without becoming subject to the laws of that country. They're considered, they have immunity from the laws of the local society. They won't be attacked by the courts in that country. They're considered outside. They're sovereign. They're representatives of their own sovereign. So that's what gives rise to the diplomatic license plates, for example, which everybody loves to complain about, because some diplomats of other countries, not American diplomats, we always try to follow the rules overseas, mostly. I know that in New York, it's a terrible problem. Do you know which two countries are the worst offenders of the traffic laws in New York? Well, it used to be the Soviet. Probably the Saudis, but the Israelis are some of the worst. The Soviets used to be pretty bad, too. And there's some other scoff laws as well. The purpose of diplomatic immunity is not to keep people away from traffic tickets or from running red lights. That's not the point. It's to protect them in the commission of their official duties. That is, their official acts are immune. It doesn't mean that they can go out and rob and steal and cause mayhem. That's sometimes misunderstood. They are not fully immune. They are immune for their official acts. Now, over the years, more and more traditions got added to the concept of who is a diplomat. And a big step forward for all of mankind was the Treaty of Westphalia in 1648, when it was more or less decided that that each state would control its territory, and there would be sovereignty and immunity of those borders, and that the sovereign had rights within those borders, and that everybody else should mind their own business. Now, of course, every once in a while there would be a war and a breakdown of civility and so on, but the idea was that the state became the basic building block of the international community. And along with that came the development of a rather hazy concept, but those of you who are lawyers, and I know that we have at least one new lawyer today in the group sitting right here, the international community realized that if everyone was sovereign, then any sovereign state could do what it wanted. And so there, over the centuries, there has been an effort to codify and to amplify the responsibilities of nation states, to try to emphasize the cooperation between states, the need to respect certain norms, to respect each other's borders and rights, and so on. And there also has been a concomitant effort to codify the laws of war, the Geneva Conventions being the most clear example of that effort. In the diplomatic realm, it's the Vienna Convention, which basically covers the diplomatic side of things. It even specifies that an ambassador of a foreign state can fly the flag of his state over his house and put the flag on his car. So some of it's quite specific, but the main thing is this idea of the inviolability of the embassy of the state that is being represented by that embassy. Now, in 1979, there was a terrible breakdown. Where? In Tehran, when the students at that time overran my old embassy. I wasn't there at the time, but and took it over and took all our hostages. Now, this was a flagrant violation of all preceding understandings of diplomatic inviolability, and that we still are feeling the effects of that action today. And part of the reason that the United States has put a whole slew of sanctions on Iran, it goes back to that original wrong that was done to us when our people were taken hostage. Now, of course, over the years, not only have memories to some degree faded, but also the need to get on with business with Iran has grown. There have been other problems, in particular Iran's role in the Middle East with regard to Israel and so on. And we can talk about some of those things. But coming to the question of career, a diplomat has to represent his own country. He's not there to represent anyone else's interest but those of the government that sent him. So that means that anyone considering a career in the U.S. Foreign Service has to be worldwide available. You can't choose where you want to go. You have to be available to go literally anywhere with no ifs, ands, or buts. You must spout the party line. You must work always for your own country's interests. And one of the things that diplomats most dislike is what they call localitis. When an ambassador or any diplomat becomes too involved with the local society and stops representing his own country's interests. And you know what I'm leading up to here. I'm a bad example. A very bad example. But only in one respect. And that was on this supremely difficult issue of the Armenian Genocide. In no other case that I'm aware of did I ever do anything but carry out my instructions as I was told to do. But on this particular issue, I ran up against a terrible dilemma, a moral and ethical dilemma. Now, in the smaller of my little books, the one that I called Therefore God Must Be Armenian, with all due apologies to the clergy for that, one of my speeches there was to the Armenian Professional Society, who wanted to call me Professional of the Year. And my speech to them was basically saying, you got the wrong guy, because I violated the rules of my own profession. That is, I broke, while in office, as ambassador, as a president's representative, I broke with my own government's policy with regard to the Armenian Genocide. That is a cardinal sin for a professional diplomat. And that's why some of my former colleagues think of me as there are different words they use, from loose cannon to idiot, no doubt, some consider that it was treason. It was not treason. I did this not for the benefit of Armenia, but because I felt that it was an American issue and it was wrong for the U.S. government to be massively misleading its own citizens about this 90-year-old historical issue. Now, I won't elaborate on that. One of the reasons I wrote Truth Held Hostage, the larger book, is precisely to explain to people, both my colleagues and to others and to American citizens, why I did what I did. And why I would do it again with no regrets. But it was not the professional thing to do. I basically could have been a good diplomat and stayed within the box and retired with all honors, or I could have been a decent human being on this issue of genocide. And I was torn. There is a lesson in this. If any of the young people here today aspire to be American diplomats, let them be aware, first of all, that they will have to go to whatever country they're assigned to, wherever the Foreign Service needs them, and to learn the languages of whatever that place might be, and to follow U.S. policy. It's not possible to join the U.S. Foreign Service and immediately say, well, I know Armenian, I want to go to Yerevan. It doesn't work that way. We have had we do have Armenian Americans in the U.S. Foreign Service, some very good ones. I have one on my staff, Aaron Sharinian, who some of you might know from Pasadena. And there's Rafi Balian, who's currently in Budapest, I believe. So there are some, But they find that they have to be in the mainstream. They can't allow themselves to be seen as apologists for any country, whether it's Armenia or any other. Now, our country is built of immigrants. Some of us have been here longer than others. But the Foreign Service looks askance at anybody whose loyalty to the United States might be in doubt. That's one thing. But I want to get back to the very good things that Nora said. For people in the diaspora living here, what you're doing with your advocacy days and with your political activities advancing Armenian issues, awareness of those issues and furtherance of those issues, that is diplomacy in its essence. It's not the same kind of diplomacy. It's not interstate diplomacy. It's intrastate diplomacy. It's internal diplomacy. But it is it's one community, or maybe a community of many, which doesn't always agree on everything, but still, that advocacy uses the same skills of argumentation, of logic, of persuasion, that diplomats use every day with their colleagues. And so I think one can be a diplomat of the Armenian community in the halls of Congress and in the city council in Los Angeles and in various other fora where political matters are discussed. So even though you may not have a diplomatic passport, which by the way is greatly overrated, it doesn't get you anywhere. It just gets you extra screening by TSA, usually. And I don't have one now, I'm retired. But do think that through, that that this political work that the AMC and other organizations carry out is a form of diplomacy. It is bringing to bear the all the skills, all the historical references, all the legal arguments, all the human rights arguments and so on, and marshaling those facts and those arguments to try to make a difference and to try to influence policy and influence public opinion, because diplomacy used to be the private preserve of kings and emperors, and in those days they only appointed nobles to be the diplomats. They're sort of their peers, the aristocracy. It was a game of the aristocrats. And in fact, until 1913, even in this country, one had to have an independent income to serve as a U.S. diplomat. You had to prove that you had this independent income, because the government wasn't going to pay you much of anything. Now, some people, particularly if they were consuls in places like Liverpool, they collected fees for carrying out certain consular duties and then supplemented their income. It was only after World War I that the United States established a professional basis for selecting people to be in the Foreign Service, and they were given a salary they could live on, and expenses were paid for other things they had to do, such as entertainment. So, many of you will be diplomats. Some may choose the course of going in to be official diplomats, but many of you, I would say, will be actual diplomats in advocacy. Okay, let me leave it there. We can come back if there are questions. I'd be happy to answer any questions on that. I'll just briefly characterize my book, the main book, Truth Held Hostage. The first part of it is really just my story of starting out, born in Virginia, never knew an Armenian in Virginia. There weren't many Armenians there, although later on I discovered that there'd been one. It was Martin, the Armenian, who was in the Virginia colony as early as 1619, and he had been brought there to foster the silk industry that everybody thought that might be quite appropriate for the hot, humid climate of Virginia. And he and another Armenian, whose name was, they called him George, it was probably Gevork, they actually brought mulberry trees to Virginia, and you can still see them in my hometown of Williamsburg, these old mulberry trees that I remember climbing on. And they got some very good yields of silk, but then came tobacco. And tobacco was so profitable that it just wiped out anything else. And the silk industry never really took off. But anyway, the book is really my story of gradually, by degrees and by steps, learning about Armenians. For example, when I went to Tehran, my landlord was an Armenian. And actually, I saw his son last night. He's now over here, and I had advised him at one point on how to apply for college and so on. And then, when I was on the Soviet desk in 1988, at the time of the earthquake, I was put in charge of our relief efforts for the Spitak earthquake. And that was quite a it was a milestone, and I describe it in my book. I've also put in one chapter that's about my time in Iran, just to give a flavor for what it's like to be a young foreign service officer in a fairly wild and woolly place. And as it turned out, Azeris and Armenians played a role in that little episode that I described, which involves unearthing a dead body, among other things. But anyway, you have to read that. But then in the center of the book, what I've tried to do is discuss this question of genocide with relation to the Genocide Convention and with relation to other factors weighing on the issue. And what has been said, it's not a complete compendium the way Harut's book is, although I leaned on that, and I owe a lot to Harut for unearthing the secret video that was made of my remarks up in Fresno, which somehow you've managed to find. And the text of that is in the book. I wasn't reading from official notes at that point, so I would have lost the text if it hadn't been for the video. And then in the third part, I've thrown out, mainly for purposes of discussion, 10 ideas of things that could be done to address mainly the Turkish-Armenian issue, the problem of relations there. Now, one or two of these ideas were dead on arrival, as a matter of fact. Unfortunately, the question of the possible Armenian genocide museum in Washington. At the time, we thought that might actually happen, but as you all know, got involved in lawsuits and counter-lawsuits and so on, and it now is not going to happen in that form. But a couple of the other ideas, I think, might have legs, might be possible to put into practice, but I just want to emphasize that the book is meant to be a starting point for discussion. It's not wholly writ, it's just my ideas. I have read a lot about this issue, and I have stayed interested in Armenian politics and the foreign policy issues there. So it's just meant to be a conversation starter. So if any of you would like to purchase the book. But let's talk a little bit about Karabakh. And by the way, if at any point there are questions, please don't hesitate. Just put up your hand and we'll get to them right away. When I was ambassador in Yerevan, 2004 to 2006, I had strict instructions not to even think about crossing the recognized border and going to Karabakh. We had no permission to do that because, according to international law, then and today, the area that was under Soviet rule, the Nagorno-Karabakh Autonomous Region, is considered to be under the jurisdiction of Azerbaijan. Now, as much as we may deplore that and regret that, that is the official stance of the group of nation states who are very attentive to these things, partly because they look at their own interests. Many of the nation states themselves are threatened by possible secession of sometimes their prized provinces. If you think of Spain and Catalonia, you think of the problems with the Basques, also in Spain and to a lesser degree in Karabakh. And I should mention this recent news about the amendment of the Karabakh Constitution to add the term Artsakh. Up until now, it has been the Republic of Nagorno-Karabakh, either in Russian or Lernaim Karabakh in Armenian. But now they have decided to give an alternate name, which is Artsakh. And we understand that that's a historical name. It does have weight because it refers back to an ancient history, a time when Artsakh was known as an Armenian land. But I hate to say it, but the fact of the matter is that the international community today takes as its starting point not the ancient roots of Artsakh, but that moment when the Soviet Union collapsed in 1991 and the 15 republics of the Soviet Union became independent overnight, almost overnight. And of course the Karabakh war was already underway at that point. Armenia won. The Armenians won, I should say. And one of the issues here is Baku doesn't want to consider this a civil war, but that's really what it was. It was one part of Azerbaijan which had under the Soviet system virtual autonomy. Baku revoked the autonomy, which very much affected the situation. And of course, the conflict got worse and was only. I'm skipping over all sorts of milestones, including the referendum and so on. But is this a civil war within Azerbaijan? The authorities in Baku say no. Armenia conquered part of our territory. Now, if you put that to anybody, just an ordinary person on the street, they'll say, oh, well, countries shouldn't invade each other and take each other's territory. But this is so much more complex than that, as we all know. So I think Armenia's reason for not recognizing the independence of Karabakh is for a couple of reasons. I think it's being kept in reserve as something that might be done at a future moment, and even just the having the potential to do it is a kind of a weapon in itself. But I think also there has been a feeling in Yerevan that we have to sort of spread our protective wing over Karabakh, and they might get off the reservation, and there may be some other considerations that I'm not sure of. In my time, the negotiating was always done on the Armenian side by a president who actually was from Karabakh, namely Robert Kocharyan and then Serge Sargsyan. But I can foresee the day when the elite in the Republic of Armenia is no longer going to have its roots in Karabakh. And from my visit this summer to Karabakh, I got the sense, having little basis for comparison, I have to admit, because it was my first visit, but I had the sense that really the people in Karabakh have to some extent grown up and grown to some degree away from the Republic. They feel themselves very much to be Karabakhsi, and not to be Yerevansi for sure. And even there's a difference in the language now. I'm not fluent enough to catch these differences, but my Armenian friends coached me through it a bit. And I even got a t-shirt that is written in the Armenian, the Karabakh dialect. And very literate Armenian friends of mine here in the United States couldn't make head or tail out of it. It had something about laugh in there. And finally I got the answer, and it basically says, everything's fine. And so in Karabakh, there's a different sensibility, there's a different feeling, there's a lot more Russian spoken. It's a kind of a slightly different kind of atmosphere and civilization there. Now, let me say a word or two about my visit to Karabakh in June. In April, when the four-day war took place, I was shocked, and I think a lot of people were shocked. A lot of people had been warning against about increasing tension, because more and more violations of the ceasefire were occurring. Every night there was shooting. The numbers of victims was going up month to month. Even in 2008, at the end of the Georgian War, Tom Duvall, who's one of the leading experts on the Caucasus, said, if you think Georgia was dangerous, Karabakh is even more dangerous, and we should look to that. That was in 2008. So since that time, a number of careful observers have been warning against exactly what happened in April. Now, what exactly were the reasons for it happening just then? There's been a lot of speculation about that. The fact that both President Sargsyan and President Aliyev were in Washington for the nuclear summit at that time, and that the fighting actually began while President Sargsyan was taking commercial air back to Armenia, but Aliyev was on his private Boeing with communications, winging his way back to Baku. So there's room for speculation there. There's also, in my mind, a question about what the two presidents, and particularly Aliyev, took away from their meetings with certain American officials, most notably the vice president. Because the last person Aliyev is known to have met with in the administration was Joe Biden. Now, Joe Biden is a sensible guy, but I can imagine that possibly Aliyev figured that he'd had a very warm meeting with the American vice president, and so this is the right time to take a serious try at defeating Karabakh. In any case, I didn't just go over there on my own. I was advising Garo Armin of the Children of Armenia Fund, who wanted to expand operations into Karabakh, and I agreed to go with him and help him figure out how to do it. We met with the president, we met with the foreign minister, we met with the prime minister, we even met with the defense minister and the health, education, science, and culture ministers. Now, American diplomats are not supposed to deal with the de facto authorities. I warned the State Department that I was going to go over there. They took it pretty well. They weren't happy, but I think it was better that I told them that I was going to do it. I found it very interesting, first of all, and we also went to Mardukert, and we talked to the local people, we talked to the governor, and we heard a below description of how the attack started. In the wee hours of the morning, the governor got a call that they were under attack, and it was the real thing, and it was full force. And so lots of phone calls were made to Stepanakert and to the village mayors and so on. The Armenian side fell back under pressure. Apparently, the Azeris used special forces in the initial attack. But once the Armenians, more or less by late morning of that day, the Armenians had gotten into strong positions and were holding. Eventually, by about the third day, it looked as if the Armenians could actually advance, although it was going to be tough. And by this time, the Russians were already talking to both sides and trying to get them to stop, pointing out that the 1994 ceasefire had never gone out of effect. It's without date and needed to be respected still. So by day four, it was brought to a close. But before it came to a close, the Azeris apparently just let fly everything they had, all this weaponry and so on. They just used it. And it has caused a lot of damage in a number of the villages there. You can see houses with the roofs gone and all sorts of other damage. So it was very bad. And the refugees from Mardiker and Martuni were put into hotels in Stepanakert. Of course, schools were damaged, and school year was interrupted and so on. So one of the things that the children of Armenia wanted to try to do was, and did do this past summer, was to set up summer camps where they took some of the children, now some of them orphaned, at least of their fathers, to try to get them back into a more normal state of mind. So that was done both in the north and in the south. One thing that President Sahakyan said really stuck with me, or two things. He said, first of all, and they all said, you know, we're here and we're not going anywhere. We're staying. We're not going to go. Some of them said, rather than leave, we will fight to the last minute. And I believe it. The way they said it, I just believe it. They are stubborn people. They believe they have a right to be there. And the president said another thing that struck me. He said, the international community has misunderstood this conflict. And I think he's right about that in some respects. These rules of diplomacy that I was talking about a few minutes ago do not, they're general rules. They don't take into account every case and the specifics of each case. Now, we know what happened in 1922 when at first the Bolsheviks assigned Karabakh to Armenia, and then almost the next day Stalin turned it around and put it into Stalin being a Georgian. No, I but it is notable that he was a Georgian. That's to leave it at that. Put it into Karabakh as a way, no doubt, of obtaining leverage on both. And of course, that's what we see now when the Soviet Union has collapsed and the autonomy is gone. Then you've got a real problem, and that's what we're dealing with there. I won't go into detail about the diplomatic work that's being done on it through the Minsk group and the three co-chairs, except to say this, that first of all, Armenia could not have three states more friendly and sympathetic to Armenia than Russia, France, and the United States. And so, although it's frustrating to see that they haven't solved the problem, by the way, their mandate is not to solve the problem, is to assist the parties in finding a political resolution of the problem. It's easy to blame the mediators, say they're not doing a good job, but they are working as hard as they can. And it's up to the parties eventually to find a way to resolve this without using violence. And every time Azerbaijan resorts to violence, they are breaking one of the principles on which European security is founded, the principle that one should not resort to violence in settling interstate disputes. how that principle has been violated many times over the years, but that is the goal. Just one other point about the so-called Madrid principles, which are a subset of the Helsinki principles, which are the main, the 10 principles that were agreed upon in 1975. The Madrid principles basically suggest that some version of a return of occupied territories in exchange for peace and status, with the difficult question of Lachin and Kelbajar being the main area for dispute or for continuing conversation. That's the basic deal, is sort of land for peace. Now, after April, it got much more difficult because people in Karabakh, although they never trusted the Azeris, there was a certain degree of familiarity with the nighttime shooting, and they sort of got used to it and maybe let their guard down a little bit. But this event in April has changed all that. They are now absolutely on guard and do not trust anything the Azeris say, and I think it's going to be a very, very long time. It may be, let me finish my sentence, a long time before we can really think about a resolution of this problem. But in the meantime, it is important that the negotiations continue, because both by having a negotiating process, one is at least forcing the two sides to repeatedly say, yes, we are in favor of a peaceful resolution. And I think one of the reasons that the Armenian forces, in fact, they told us that one of the reasons they did not advance when they could have is they wanted to send a signal that Armenia does favor a peaceful resolution and is committed to the negotiating process. So I would just say that we have to be careful about imagining that throwing out the Minsk group would make it easier to resolve this. It wouldn't. It actually would simply mean that without a diplomatic road forward, the only alternative to that is war. And in that war-torn part of the world, I think that nobody needs that. There's been enough violence in that part of the world. So let me basically stop there. And somebody asked me the other night, what's going to be the situation in Karabakh in 10 years? Well, I'm not a fortune teller. I don't know. I'm not the honest answer. But I would imagine that we will see a situation in which hopefully Karabakh is better defended, stronger economically, more developed socially, and yet still in a situation of needing to keep its guard up while at the same time negotiating. That's what I think we'll see in 10 years. Thank you very much. The creation of Kosovo out of Yugoslavia without the assent of Belgrade was a violation of the Helsinki principles, under which there can be changes of borders, but it has to be peaceful. Now, Czechoslovakia, as you know, also, I was there at the time, in fact, when it split into Czech and Slovak parts, it was done very peacefully. There might have been a bar fight or two, but nothing serious. But it was actually unconstitutional. So there are all sorts of little odd things. Now, I do believe that what we're seeing in the Soviet, in the former Soviet Union, is really the wars of the Soviet succession. A great empire collapsed in 1991, and immediately, well, you already had Nagorno-Karabakh raging. You then had Transnistria, which didn't want to be part of Moldova. You have the Abkhaz, who don't want to be Georgians, and the South Ossetians, who don't want to be Georgians. And on the other side, you had the titular nationalities, the Georgians, who said, Georgia is for Georgians, and you, the rest of you, are all just outsiders, guests of our country. So there are commonalities. I think Ukraine was the most serious of these wars of the Soviet succession, but that's the old empire, when it lost its authority and collapsed into these individual states, allowed old animosities and different agendas to rise to the top with the consequence that we see. Let's take one more, since that was only one question.
Thank you very much. If you are an Arafat and you want to have your country places and stay as an Armenian and not going to the Azerbaijanis or whatever influences, what you're going to do to survive, not for 10 years, for the eternity?
You're going to make the commitment to defend your land, come hell or high water, which they are doing. I didn't mention the new factor of the Israeli drone that was used for the first time in combat in April. That puts a new dimension, literally the vertical dimension, into this thing. But Karabakh has to defend itself and at the same time strengthen itself and at the same time negotiate. That's, and it may take more than 10 years.
As a moderator, I'm going to ask a little lighter question. You know, WikiLeaks leaked all these diplomatic cables in Washington, and some of them belong to you. Could you make a comment about some of these leaks, or anything there that you'd rather not have you received? I know I came to the embassy once in Yerevan and met with one of your friends, successors, Ivanovich, and my name was in one of the papers. So could you say something about the WikiLeaks and the leaks?
I had no problem.
Mr. Sasunya, I also want us to have a round of applause for like young people who stayed all the way. Honestly. So I really hope the stuff that we talked about today and the topics that we discussed becomes topic of discussion tonight during dinner time. Now we have a few more things that we have to do and we'll be done. I promise we can all go watch football. I'm going to introduce our chairman for closing remarks and a few things for Arvind Vasaryadas.
It would lead us to Armenia's stability and to become a nation that we are all have been proud of from Dikran Medz all the way to today. So let's keep that spirit, and your presence today proves that we have still a long way to go, but we will get there.
One day we'll get there.
Now, there are no words to describe this man's courage. There are no words that would justify our thankfulness for his straight-faced, for his intellectual honesty, that he has put everything on the line, his career on the line, to speak the truth. In these days, everybody, when he's becoming politically correct, this man for years have been politically incorrect and has stood for the truth and has written books for which we are grateful. Ambassador Evans mentioned Liverpool. I happen to be a Liverpool Football Club fan. And we have a saying in Liverpool, you'll never walk alone. Which means that when there is a tragedy, when there is despair, when there is difficulties, we say to each other, you'll never walk alone, because we've got you back. Mr. Ambassador, thank you for not letting us walk alone. You walked with us. You earned our respect. And for that, we take our hat off for you. Thank you very much. called Nishan Kulukyan, who is a longtime member of the ANCA West, in order for him and I to present our token of appreciation with a plaque to Ambassador Evans. And Nishan will read what it's written on it.
Mr. Ambassador. As a token of appreciation from this community, the Armenian National Committee is proud to present you this certificate of appreciation because of your commitment and your assistance in the Armenian affairs. It reads, the Armenian National Committee of San Fernando Valley West hereby presents this certificate of appreciation to the Honorable John Evans, former U.S. Ambassador to Armenia, in appreciation of outstanding and invaluable service to Armenians and to the promotion of the Armenian cause.
Thank you very much.
Now, because you have vehemently defended the truth about the Armenian cause, and because the Armenian National Committee feels that you have been a defender of the Armenian cause, we would like to make you an honorary member of the Armenian National Committee.
I'm not only honored, but very surprised, but I also want to say that this really should be for my wife, who is known as Dashnak Dana.
Dear friends, the ambassador will take a seat at the signing of the books right now. Please, everybody that wishes to have his books, and we encourage you to come in and purchase these books, and he will sign them personally, autograph them, so that you may have it for centuries to come.